Thank you very much. Greetings, everyone, and welcome to beautiful San Diego. It's great to see you all here. As we've said in the past, Cedia Expo often feels more like a family reunion than a trade show. It's a great chance to reconnect, to make new friends, and catch up with old colleagues. If this is your first time at the show, I'm certain you'll see what I'm talking about very soon. This is a close-knit community of people who love what they do. That's why it's such an honor for me to serve in the position I hold. A big part of my job, obviously, is working with the board and Cedia staff to implement Cedia's new strategic mission. We are all committed to making your association the most effective it has ever been. We are focusing our talents and resources on areas that will directly impact you, our members. One of our biggest priorities is education. In addition to the robust class offerings you can take right here at Expo, you'll see dozens of new classes by the end of the year. And delivery of those courses will be vastly improved with a new learning management system. We know the industry at large, like a lot of trades, is suffering from the lack of skilled workforce. This is a tremendous initiative for Cedia. Leading the charge is Tony Tabor, who brings a decade of experience to this position as Cedia's Director of Workforce Development. Additionally, Walt Zerbe is leading the effort for us in increasing professionalism in the industry by working to develop standards and best practices. We are also focused on marketing the experiences of our members to provide other industries, reaching out to designers, builders, architects, and all the other specifiers that can help us build business. Among direct marketing and educational activities to these groups, we will again host the Cedia Smart Home Pavilion at Design and Construction Week, the co-location of the Kitchen and Bath Show and the International Builder Show. One exciting piece of business that we just announced last week was the acquisition of the Cinema Designer software, renamed the Cedia Designer. This software was developed by renowned cinema designer Guy Singleton, and it creates a technically perfect home theater or media room with full documentation. It produces the design in minutes using all the products you know and spec now. Cedia members have free access to level one of the media room software as a benefit of your membership. We are hosting demos each day, so I hope you will stop by the Cedia booth to get on the schedule. While at the booth, I hope you'll vote for the 2019 and 2020 Board of Directors. This is an incredibly important decision as these members will serve a two-year term influencing the direction of this industry, governing the association's activities, representing the residential technology profession to the outside world. A big part of what Cedia members provide to their customers, part of what makes life live best at home, are the many ways we bring content into people's homes. Music, movies, games, name it. That's why we're very excited about this year's keynote speaker. His position demands that he study the intersection of content and technology, how they affect one another, and how this changing landscape can provide opportunities for your businesses. Please welcome the Executive Vice President of Consumer Business Development and Strategic Partnerships for 20th Century Fox, Mr. John Penney.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate that. Thank you. Welcome. You know, this is my first Cedia, so I'm really excited to be here. Just so I feel at home, is it anybody else's first Cedia Expo? Cool, I'm not alone. We can get together later on and talk about it, because I think it's going to be really exciting. I'm going to show you something, and then we're going to dive right in. It's going to be interesting, I hope, for you, and a little bit different than your past Cedia keynotes. Here we go. Our theme today is going to be decoding all of what's going on in the world of media and content. I come from the world of content and have spent many years in content companies in different roles. And in these roles, I certainly feel that I have developed the expertise to help you guys understand what's going on within content companies today in their goals of getting to you, the consumer, new business models, and certainly in this incredible mega merger activity set we see out in the market, which is creating so much noise. Hence the title of our presentation, Decoding the Signal of What's Really Important Going Forward from the Noise. Before I dive in, I would love to thank the Cedia team for having me, my first Cedia. I'm a content guy. I'm sort of like one of those jokes where the horse walks into the bar. You know, the horse walks in and the bartender goes, why the long face? Well, it's a little bit different for me because I know content is something that you guys all really actually bring to consumers' lives in very powerful ways. But not many folks get up on this stage and talk about the behind the scenes of content. So I think it'll be interesting for you, and you'll also see how these large media companies and distribution companies and the new internet competitors are going to radically transform at least the content in the home environment, which sets you guys up for a wonderful opportunity, I think, in continuing the amazing things that you've done in the home. Just to give you a quick sense, my background covers content strategy, business development, but most importantly, the economics of content. And I'm going to try and give you some background on that, because it's really monetization and business models, as we'll see, that's driving many of these large mergers that are happening out in the market. I happen to be involved in one, not directly. I came to Fox only 18 months ago, and after 6 months, I found out we were being acquired by Disney. Talk about a big wow. I mean, this is major stuff going on in Time Warner, obviously in AT&T. And so thinking about what we'll explore today, you know, I wanted to say one thing before we dive in, which is in our exploration, I'm going to talk about technologies, but I'm really going to talk about content and how that drives the media and entertainment ecosystem and ultimately impacts the home environment that you guys are so expert at. And the technologies in the home, you have many more years of experience and forgotten more than I know about those technologies. So I'm going to make some comments about technology, but I just want you to know I'm not an engineer. I'm not a technologist. So please do forgive me if I somehow misread the tea leaves, but this whole session that we're having today is really designed, hopefully, to start a dialogue amongst us all. So if you see things that I say that, you know, may not match up with reality, I want to know. Let's get together and talk about those, because the more we all work together to make the consumer's life better in the home and with the great content that Hollywood and other entities produce, the better it is for all of us. So let's dive in. This is a really interesting slide. It's not an eye chart, it's a bunch of bubbles. Kids would love to, you know, poke at bubbles. And what these bubbles are is the media and entertainment landscape of the United States, content companies and distributors, roughly about a year and a half to 2 years ago. You know, in the United States, we love our media and entertainment. Just television advertising, which certainly has been going sort of a flat curve over the last 3 to 4 years, is $75 billion. Another, probably $70, $80 billion in cable, $40 billion in affiliate fees paid to content companies by cable operators. Just a massive business that doesn't take theaters into account, all this other, you know, business opportunity out there in the media and entertainment landscape. But this giant chart is really about a world that's radically transforming. And what's happening is, and we're going to go through this step by step, so you have a framework that you can take away that I hope will be helpful for you, thinking about the in-home environment and what you do for your clients. But ultimately, we have a framework, ultimately we have a world here where giant distribution companies like AT&T, Comcast, and the like, and content companies are merging together. And that's what this merger madness is that we see going on today in the market. So let's dive in, talk a little bit more about this, because what's really going to be interesting is we're going to be looking at a giant battle for the heart and soul of media, content, and entertainment between traditional media and entertainment companies, which are now going to be part of other companies, as you'll see, and the internet giants of Facebook, Google, Amazon, and Netflix and the like, who have become media companies in their own right. They're platform companies, and most importantly, they're engineering-led software companies. We're going to talk about that. But they are media companies by every account. So why are all these mega mergers happening? Well, as I speak, and we're here right now, companies that have direct-to-consumer access like Netflix and Hulu are the belle of the ball. We're going to talk about why that's the case. But these other companies are coming together, incredibly large transactions. It started way back with Comcast and Universal of 2010. But these companies are really merging because there's the need for content and distribution to have a direct relationship to the consumer. We're going to dive into that, why that's important, and why that direct relationship to the consumer happens in the environment that you guys bring the most value to, in the home, and increasingly out of the home. So while some of what we're going to hear about today is theoretical, I want you to remember that everything we're going to talk about a shift that's going to happen in the next 3 to 5 years. And I think this can give you all a decided advantage in thinking about how content experiences will play out in the home, which may inform your clients in the high end, the middle, and the low, and what they want from services and content in their environment, whether it's gaming, video, audio, and the other services and connected opportunities. So let's think about something. For years, media companies, TV, I worked in HBO and Viacom, and we had very little data about what the consumer was doing. There were Nielsen ratings, you guys know this stuff. There's very little information, it was a one-way pipe. And that's a critical piece of what's changing now. Well, today the consumer is in the middle of the media and entertainment value chain. And consumers are going to be participants in a two-way dialogue with every media company and device manufacturer through their activities on all connected devices in the home. Large screen connected TVs, set-top boxes, devices in their pocket, all the rest delivered through IP services. So this new consumer reality is going to underpin a lot of what we're going to see today and what's going on in the media landscape and how that bridges into the home. One of the pieces that I wanted to bring to this conversation, and hopefully this will work, is I wanted to show you how the group here, Cedia members, and the folks in this room who bring content, technology, and all manner of products and services to consumers can really profit from change. So I feel like if we understand why all of this transformation of content companies merging, direct-to-consumer, battle with the internet giants, all of this good stuff, if we can put a framework around it, which I'm going to try and do for you, then it might help, and as this plays out, because we're only in the early stages of this, that it might get you a step ahead in your businesses to serve your client bases, whether it be small, medium, or large. Okay, this is risky, so I'm going out on a limb here. I'm actually going to give you right now, in 7 points, all the takeaways from the presentation. I'm going to do this for 2 reasons. The first is, some people like the punchline before the joke. No, I'm kidding. Actually, I think it might organize what's coming next. But the really important reason is, many of you flew in from far away, and you may be tired. So if you do want to doze off, or you're thinking about the bar that I'm standing between you and that drink of choice, well, at least you'll have it all up front. It's 7 points. It's going to take me a little bit to go through. It'll frame what we have, but at least we'll at least be bound together with a few points while we were all awake and maybe listening. The first point is that in this merger dynamic and in this merger-fueled world where big companies like Fox and Disney are coming together, what's really happening is these big media companies that were once standalone and now are going to be owned by telecoms and, you know, cable companies, they want to become direct-to-consumer companies. No more wholesale business models. No more selling to a cable company and then have the data not come back. No more selling to a movie theater and not know how much popcorn people ate or whether they even liked the movie. So really the simple fact is that being disintermediated from your customer is an incredible disadvantage in media and entertainment. And if you think about the data that Netflix has about you, if you have Netflix or Hulu or Amazon or any of these companies around media, they use it to optimize their products. And media companies don't have that. And they don't have also a software-driven philosophy in the heart of their company. Because those other companies I mentioned, big internet companies, we're really going to dive into this, are software companies. Really hardcore. Not nice red carpet software like media and entertainment. Hardcore software. And they use those platforms to improve their product. And the content is the worm on the hook to do that. You guys know that because you see that in the home. But really that is the number one point here to take away. And whether it's in home or out of home, it really does carry through. Two. Data is the new oil and energy source for the entertainment economy. We just said it. Data and direct-to-consumer relationships drives personalization, product advantage, targeted advertising. I'm going to show you a little bit about this. And content companies' ability to create value from their products and productions. Game companies, movie companies, TV companies, radio, audio, all the like. It's all about consumer data. These giant companies called Google, Facebook, Amazon, were built on data infrastructures. We're going to look at that. The next piece that's critical that we're going to dive into, but you'll learn right now, is that subscription business models for content services are the new holy grail. Transactions and advertising-driven models are great. We need them, but they're unpredictable. Subscriptions have recurring revenue streams. They produce high rates of cash flow when you get large businesses like a Netflix or an Amazon's Prime service. And they're really like, you remember the old razor and blades analogy, right? Where you don't have lifetime value in selling a razor once. You have lifetime value in the blades. So if inexpensive set-top boxes and sidecar boxes are the razors, the blades are the subscription services. And they're data-enabled because they are large network effects businesses. Lots of people subscribing means you can optimize for any one individual through AI and machine learning. Next, the battle for market share in the home by these large technology providers, and this is where you guys are right in the middle of this, and it's really cool, is there are going to be more devices, more services, a heterogeneous environment, I believe, and more entertainment products to offer, more opportunities around home automation and security, because you have these amazingly large internet players and smaller third-party companies. Think what Ring became when it went from, not endorsing it or anything like that, but it went from being Ring in Santa Monica to being a part of Amazon or Google's Nest. This is really the world in which these large data-enabled companies are binding together in the home, connected devices and content. So this is another key piece. The in-home environment over the next 3 years will be very, I believe, will be more heterogeneous. Fourth takeaway. If you walk down the aisle in Best Buy, you see whole sections in home automation, audio, video that's connected. You see it. I see it too. It's amazing that it's there. People are buying it, but they don't often know how to put it together. That's why they have you guys. They don't know how to create an in-home environment. But these large internet players need those touch points to the consumer through, it says, ask Google out there, or an Amazon Echo, or a Disney set-top that there may be one day. And those things will be the cross points between the content, the consumer, the data, and what you construct in the home is the most valuable service offering for a consumer. Whether they're at the high end and they want Ultra HD, many of folks will want everything through the stack. And really the last point, I believe the most important point, is that you all in this room are really the front line and are uniquely positioned to generate long-term value for your clients. And really do it as trusted resources. I don't want to make this sound too, academic, but you're their educators, you're their advocates, you're their trusted providers. And since you have that relationship and capability, you've amended tremendous power to help them bring what you're going to see is obviously going to be a more complex world going forward to a simplicity that I think will really delight them. They demand performance. They want the best at whatever price point they have. But that old line, I want my grandma to be able to do it, right? Use it. Well, it's really they crave simplicity too. And you guys in this more complex world that we're going to talk about are there at the cross cut to make that a reality for them. We're going to take a quick trip down memory lane to set up the world that we're in now, and then we're going to dive into business models, and you're going to see a little bit about where media and entertainment is going in the home through the lens of content and business models. Well, it was great when we could all gather around a TV set, social viewing. That was a long time ago. In the 40 years ago, we saw everything from the phone to standalone audio video, and even cable in the early 70s come into prominence. Just as a note, HBO, I worked there for about 7 years. We started in 1972. And what I'm going to do in this quick trip down memory lane is just talk to you about the business models more than what went on, because you guys know all this. But the business models in the early days, one-way advertising. There was one subscription service. It was HBO in 72. Showtime started in 76. Stars in 91. You were paying a cable operator, but it was very limited. The next stage really that drove media and entertainment value creation was the 80s and 90s. And why? Because you had cable proliferation, you had physical media for the first time, really important. You had the CD, roughly in 82, 83, and the VHS tape. And the in-home environment started to, bad word, complexify in a way that was actually beneficial to the consumer. And that was unique because that was the first time, back to business models. We went away from that traditional one-way ad-supported business model to now having advertising, transactions, service offerings in the home. This was the era of the rise of the home PC. We had online services. We had that crazy noise I had in the beginning, which for your young people was a modem connecting, which is an old-fashioned way of connecting to something like the internet, if not the internet itself. I know it's weird, but when I hear that, I sort of get like that fond feeling of, oh my gosh, there are not so many devices around me, only one. This, it's amazing that the iPhone was launched in the year of the Great Recession. This incredible time in the 2000s, think about this. We just set up the fact that there were more devices in the home to deliver media, connectivity. Well, cable modems came in 2003, small dish satellite overtook C-band, gateway set-top boxes, in-home networking started. This was really the makings of the modern era, and that's important, as we'll see, because ultimately all devices are being connected today, and all devices are collecting data about us as media consumers. This was really a key time when that happened. Where we are today is absolutely extraordinary. We're in a world where we all have supercomputers in our pockets. Actually, people around the world have supercomputers in their pockets. It's like 5 billion telephones, mobile phones around the world, roughly. And those are all collecting data on everybody. Simple boxes that you plug in that give you access to more content than anybody could ever imagine, from Rokus to Cast to all that good stuff. All of it tracking what we're doing at any moment in time, where we are, everything about us. And it's not a creepy reality I'm trying to describe. I'm going to try and describe a powerful reality of how that can make our lives around content and in the home better. There are creepy aspects, obviously, but those are for another discussion. But honestly, I think that what we're seeing right now, faster wireless going to 5G for fixed broadband technology that's blossoming, and this new business models of direct-to-consumer, targeted advertising, personalization that leads to subscription satisfaction. All of this is accelerating right now and is the arc of the next 3 years, which is why media and entertainment companies are emerging, to get ahead of that curve and be able to, as you'll see, boost their business models and connectivity with the consumer in order to deliver more value. So now I'm going to unleash a very big secret. So, in media and entertainment, people like to make it seem complicated. It really isn't. Making a show is hard, and having a great narrative or a TV show is hard. But I'm going to tell you about the business model. Because people call movies an art and all that good stuff. It's a commercial art. Art is where you have a patron. Commercial art, you got to make money. So I'm going to tell you the two things, whether it's a TV show, a movie, or any type of media, that you need to know, and that will help with the rest of our presentation, that defines how media companies make money. Understanding these two drivers, which are time and your wallet, will help us in the rest of our discussion. The two drivers of media monetization are your attention to media properties, movies, games, whatever might have advertising or promotion in them, which is converted to revenues through advertising. That's how the internet is making a fortune off of targeted advertising, Facebook, Google, and the like, but it's also how networks do it. The other way to make money in media, again, it's not a secret, but these two things are pretty simple, is you take money out of your pocket, you buy a subscription, you buy a disc, you buy a box that, you know, has media content on it. And those two things, your time sharing or wallet share, drive the whole value chain of media. Now think about that. Two drivers, and there's some problems here for the media and entertainment business. Again, why we're going to see these mergers taking place, which are going to transform the in-home environment. One is, there are only 24 hours in the day. It's a law of physics, right? So every time you're looking at something on your device or on your TV that's ad-supported, there's a competition for your time. So that competition for your time, if it shifts, radically can transform the economics of media. So, for example, if people are watching a lot of TV and shifted to digital viewing on digital platforms, that's really bad for TV. I'm going to show you a chart like that. You're going to go, oh my God, what's happening? So time is very precious, and it's very hard to maintain a place in the economic system of media if so many things are competing for your time, especially things in your pocket that are beeping or on my wrist that are beeping and asking me to look at them. The next piece is wallet share. And once we get by this, we're going to start really moving here. Wallet share is, again, paying for a transaction. Let me tell you something. The folks that you work with are not the average people in the United States. The median household income in the United States is $57,000. I'm going to tell you a number that's going to really, I think, jar you. But it's what we think about in media in terms of people being able to afford content. 60% of Americans, that's 200 million people, don't have $500 in savings. Okay, that's a national disaster in the making for other reasons, but for the content world, that's a big problem. They don't have money to reach into their pockets and buy a subscription or the like. They have to have ad-supported media. So there are limitations based on time and wallet, and, you know, let me throw one other stat at you because I love this one, is there are only 42 million homes in the United States that make over $75,000. Think of how every technology company, every AVCE company is trying to reach those people. So we do have real limitations here in the business models of media, of time and wallet, that play out because of macroeconomics and the physics of being a day with 24 hours. We're going to see how this works in a second. Sidelight, we talked about razor and blades business. I want you to keep this in mind as we continue to flow through the presentation. The world is moving to lifetime value metrics of customer monetization and value creation. It's not about single transactions. Did I watch an ad? It's about what's the lifetime of you spending with my media products or in front of my big screens or on my device. And that's the razors. Sorry, that's the blades, apologize. The razors are the devices. And that lifetime value is really where subscription business start to pay off. And you'll see as we talk about subscriptions that selling a single simple box, which almost are being given, when you think about the cost of bill of materials for a Roku stick, 10, 15 bucks, you guys would know. You can give that thing away in order to get the subscription value from it. That's the new reality we're in, that subscriptions are honestly the things that have unique characteristics that can't be replicated in other business models. And why this is so important is that they, in general, have more predictable business dynamics than transactional businesses. Steadier cash flows, more predictable once they get to scale. And they create powerful network effects. The more people who subscribe to your content service or these types of services up there, the more you can cross-market. That's really important to think about going forward, because this is going to be really one of the drivers of the new media landscape that all of these major media mergers like Disney, Fox, and the like are pursuing subscription business opportunities. Just a quick show of hands. Does anybody subscribe? We have makeup, food, shaving. There's obviously books. Does anybody subscribe? Coffee? Does anybody subscribe to any of those? Yeah, the razor one's a great idea because it's literally the razor blades. They lowered the cost. It's amazing. I'm sure the makeup one is good too. Quick summary. We're going to do this two times. Actually, we're going to do three times the presentation. What have we covered so far? And where are we going? I want to get this in there because I think there's going to be stuff that's going to be useful to you as we start to go behind the curtain here. So we said the basic equation in media, the fundamental one that you can all take away and tell all your friends about, is that it's time and money, but you already knew that. That powers content monetization. We talked about the power of subscription business models, the emerging power of direct to consumer. If I don't hit the mic too hard, it will, the data that you get in that relationship is really important, and that is where money is going to be created in the future of content and content creation, content distribution. And from the walk down memory lane that we took in technology, the path to more device heterogeneity in the home, more devices, more software more software connectivity or integration needed, I think. So let's go behind the curtain and do a quick deep dive, and away we go. You saw this because we did a summary, but there's more good stuff behind this slide. So we talked about data is the new oil of content monetization. And I'm going to show you some slides about the size of the companies that manage a lot of our data online. But because the internet is there, and because it can now hold and transfer massive amounts of video and audio, the direct connectivity that a company can have through a smart device or a connected device into the home or out of the home is this profound shift. And that data from collecting your activities on these devices, whether it's what you're looking at, what you're scrolling by, trick modes, what program it is, how long you stayed on it, where you were geolocated when you watched it, so thousands of variables. That data has been collected for a while, but it has never actually, until the last 4 or 5 years, been actually monetized in a sufficiently scaled way through AI and machine learning to bring the incredible value that you're going to see of these data and analytic-based internet companies. The companies, the media companies like Time Warner and Fox and Sony and the rest have so much envy around. So the value that Netflix, Amazon, Google, YouTube have created is because of data centricity. And this direct-to-consumer paradigm is really the place where we see the consumer in the middle, not at the end point or at the edge of the value chain. The consumer's in the middle, and that data is bubbling up into these large companies and being used to improve product, improve services, and ultimately we'll be able to improve content. So this blows me away. If you'd asked me about 5 years ago, would there be no independently, publicly traded large media company except for one on the planet, which will be Disney Fox, in 5 years, I would have said, you're crazy. But that's actually what's happened. Media companies are all going to be part of technology conglomerates. And why is this the case? Let's get some perspective on how the internet companies on the left, and I haven't included all of them, Amazon's not up there, I just put some samples for you, really hijacked the home entertainment ecosystem through wonderful products and services and really created global content behemoths in their own right. So if you look at the left side and those market caps, I mean, they're absolutely massive. Amazon just passed $1 trillion after Apple did. But you look at Google, Facebook, and you look at the Netflix number. Look at Netflix compared to Disney. It's roughly the same size in market capitalization of Disney. Netflix has only been streaming for roughly 7 years, and it's as valuable as the most valuable media company on the planet. Now, when Disney merges with Fox, they'll be a bigger company. But really what we're seeing here is we're seeing companies that focus on consumer data and analytics create high valuation because they're very focused on product improvement and continuous cycles of making sure that we are really fans of their product. And Netflix is a really wonderful example with its push into original programming. One last thing I want to emphasize. You remember I told you that media traditionally was a wholesale business? Well, all the companies on the right had to deal with intermediate wholesalers, cable operators, movie chains, people who had game consoles, all the like. And in this case, what we have on the left in the internet companies are connect directly into the backbone around the world, get some CDNs running, and you have your product in front of everybody in the world. I mean, Facebook is the internet in developing markets, literally. And that advantage, that seamless, frictionless way of getting to the consumer, is what's driving so much value for these internet companies, along with the ability to bring content that's exciting, whether it's user-generated, social, or professionally produced. So think about this. If you're a company like the internet guys on our slide, your Netflix or your Amazon or your Google, and you're talking about media, and you're talking about it on devices or on connected TVs, which is a great place to watch it, we know all about what you're doing. These companies know all about what you're doing. Well, that's engagement. And engagement is ultimately the crucible of what we talked about, time value and wallet value. Because if I'm engaged and I like your service and your content, I'm a fan of it. I want to keep buying it, and maybe I'll shell out more money because there's great stuff out there. So when you have engagement and you have companies that are directly connected to consumers, again, our theme from our summary in the front, you have the opportunity to run daily or minute-by-minute experiments on what keeps people engaged and what keeps them attracted to using your service and looking at your content or whatever your product offering might be, given it's a connected one, all IP delivered. And that direct engagement is the complete inverse of the old one-way, we used to call it advertising, spray and pray model, because you sprayed the advertising out, you prayed it would get to the right people. In this world, it's completely targeted, and it's targeted to an amazingly small rifle shot, which is an audience of one. You. Specifically you. Your experience on Netflix, your experience on Facebook, your experience on Amazon Prime Video is different than mine. How different is that than the experience you had when you were watching a single network like FX or HBO? It's completely different. And it's in that ability to get to you, that direct connection to your home, to your device in a different place in the home, maybe the living room or not, is now what's driving this efficient model. And that's what media companies of old, the wholesale guys, have not been able to catch up with. And that's why the mergers are bringing them together with companies that desire to catch up. So, engagement. Look at this chart. This is the number of dramas and comedies and all shows that have a script written on basic cable, broadcast, pay, which is HBO and Showtime, and online services, which are Netflix, Amazon, and Google. Look at the amount of scripted programming and its increase in these 15 years. What's really happening here is scripted series like Game of Thrones or pick whichever one you like. What these things are when they're in an IP-delivered world, and maybe on a DVR, is we call it the watch, rinse, repeat reality of programming. And I did use a shampoo analogy there, but really it's a behavior driver that if you have original programming that you can binge watch or take your time, it doesn't really matter. These are the types of things that people feel like they get a lot of value out of subscription services or their cable bundle for. So really the fascinating thing on this chart is that of the total growth from 180 roughly to 500 scripted series, which is massive growth. 115 of them, 117, have come from these new players. These guys are spending so much on content. Netflix alone spends $12 to $14 billion a year on its original programs. You say, how big is that? I can tell you HBO, this is not an exact number, but I would guess for its original spends roughly $2 billion. My God. HBO is one of the greatest networks of all time. It'll probably spend a lot more now that AT&T owns it. But these numbers are so enormous that if I added up Netflix, Amazon, I'll include Hulu and Google in there, probably could be spending about $30 to $40 billion on original TV series. This is massive, but what this shows you is how valuable the direct consumer relationship and the data is, because you would never spend that if you didn't have a business model to monetize that. It proves the fact that engagement is the ultimate economic driver. One point to reemphasize, these are all content companies, and they're very good at what they do. I love the Netflix product. It's really great. I'm going to show you a chart in a second. Amazon, fantastic things on content. And Apple's just getting into the game. I just want you to hold in your mind how they use their platforms, some their hardware, and their software to create that better consumer experience. That's what the traditional media guy never had. It was reliant on a horribly confusing, maybe UI on a DCT 1000 or 1500 box of cable where you couldn't find anything. These guys are just making it easier to get content. And when you lower those friction, when you lower that friction, you basically make consumers happy. And that's why these connected sidecar boxes, dongles, and connected TVs are such powerful devices in the home. But right here, this is the TV of choice for many people. It's a little bigger, but for most of the world, I have my phone over there. That phone in your pocket's really the TV. So don't forget, platform and software and the content coming together is the ultimate mix. So this is a little proof point for you. So Netflix, we talked about, it's only about 7 years in the original programming business, and maybe less than that. Its market cap's almost like Disney. Look at this, Netflix has more subscribers in the United States, I'm not counting their international, than cable has. Okay, don't count satellite, but cable, that's unbelievable. Yeah, cable, it's a very expensive bundle. We talked about how people may have less money in their pockets going forward, $80, $90, not including high-speed data. Netflix, $10, maybe $12, or if you you have the 4K option or whatever, login option, it's a little bit more expensive. Simple and very, very powerful. Quality platform plays wherever you want it to play. Great product. Data, using engagement to drive value. Remember we talked about timeshare. Timeshare here is an astounding reality that anybody who knows a child, or maybe younger in the room, already knows. This is an amazing chart. This is like over the last 4 years, the amount of time spent watching traditional TV by age group. I fall into, oh my God, the 50 to 64 bar. But I watch a lot less than that. I mean, mine's further down. Look at what the future of content consumption. People 2 to 24. That's our future. That's it. It's a giant cohort out there. They are watching 30 to 40% less traditional TV. Okay, John, what's traditional TV? I know you all wanted to know that. This is the scary fact. It's all linear and DVR TV. It's all TV on a TV that's not connected to a sidecar box. That's the roll-off. That's the power of these new platforms that are delivering software-based services, sidecar boxes. And what's really causing this roll-off is people are watching on these devices or on their connected sets. But this is a real problem if you own a network. You know, there are 126 pay and basic networks. But what this is showing is the way I'd like to say it to you is the future is going to be the same, only more so. Because when you look at this cohort, these young 2 to 24s, their world is device agnostic as long as it's portable and gives them what they want. They like a big screen, but they want to be able to watch where they want to watch it and when they want to watch it. That old trope that we talked about, 5-10 years ago. And this really plays to the advantage of people who have direct-to-consumer and subscription business models. So remember time and wallet share again, I bring it up. People now spend roughly three hours on their mobile phone with all types of content. Well, that sounds like a pretty big number. What does that compare to? I don't know how Americans do this. I'd love to take a poll, but I don't want to embarrass people. The average American watches 7 hours of TV a day. That's great, right? I mean, because that's where you guys are, and you're in the home, but 7 hours of TV a day, right? I mean, that's sort of crazy. And then 3 hours on this thing. So basically, that's 10 hours of the day right there. I know you can cross over being a little bit silly, but the power of that device, and I'm actually probably doing okay in this talk because not too many of you are on that. I wanted to like point at someone and say, probably Walt's on his phone. You're just putting your phone away. I saw you right there. These things are really hard to put down. They're addictive. And the reason they are is because they provide a lot of value, actually. And they provide business models that are incredibly powerful. Transactions, you can buy. Subscriptions, you're a subscriber, you can subscribe and get unlimited amounts of content, nearly all the content in the world, basically, audio and video. And of course, advertising services and so much more. Now we're going to take a poll. So we talked about increasing costs for cable and relative to digital services. We talked about time and unfortunately people having less money maybe in the future. How many people who are in this room only get their TV through an internet service? That means they don't have basic or satellite. Man, we are the future. You really are, because truthfully, whether you do it for the convenience, I know you guys are doing it for the technological sophistication, the benefits it gives you, but at some point, there's a breaking model in this where you're thinking about spending $80, $90 just for basic cable. That doesn't include high-speed data, and I'm not putting the taxes in there. Once that bill gets up to $150, that's after-tax money. If I put a normal tax rate, I'll just use 30% for a rough number. That's roughly 3 to 5% of the gross income of the median household in the United States for the whole year going to the cable company. That's a really rough ride, especially with the number of homes that are below the $75,000 mark. So the point is that this $55 million number of cord cutters, which is as big as all cable business today, may be a little bit incendiary, but it might be closer to fact than fantasy. Quick summary. So we're past the business model section. I tried to show you why. A lot of what's going on is going on in media and distribution. So these are the takeaway points, and then we're in the home stretch. Direct-to-consumer business models deliver data. Data is monetized as the new oil of engagement. Engagement is where algorithms make advantage through business models that have you buy or advertise to you or improve products. That's a great way to use engagement. Netflix uses your data to improve its product. It's not selling it to a third party. And the greater diversity of these large tech companies means the battle in the home is going to be fought around a lot of different devices, which you guys are perfectly positioned to capitalize on as a trusted source for your client base. And that's where we're going next. So this is the house of yore, not your house, but of times past. And what I really think about here is that typically in this world, we had a single TV set that was the primary set. And today we still have that, but we really are moving to a multi-location reality in the home, where device, content, and hardware and service diversity are throughout the household. And media companies love that. Remember, what media companies do with content matches to business models, and then matches to technology and the business models of technology. So media companies, remember, want to engage at many points in your life. So if they have lots of devices in the home, set-top boxes, sidecar set-top boxes, your phone, your tablet, whatever may be connected to the internet, including, if you're another type of service provider, home automation, security, all of this can be put into a model to make it more appealing to you as a customer. So if they have you at all those touch points, they can create better engagement, more personalized. And, you know, ultimately, when you have... Oh, I went back. I used the back button. Here we go. Ultimately, when you have the ability to bring all the content in the world into every room, I say in the world that we have rights to, into the room, you have a new multidimensional content world that's very powerful for the business models of media and entertainment, especially those internet-delivered players. And so you're watching, you know, in the living room, Netflix with the family on the large screen connected TV, Hulu in the bedroom, Spotify in the office. You know, the kids' room, it's definitely going to be YouTube. And in the kitchen, it's going to be, you know, Pandora or other audio services delivered. Maybe even targeted TV where you were looking at cooking shows and getting recipes. So that notion of moving geolocation from the living room to around the house and then making that a seamless experience for people is a really difficult one for folks who want their grandmother to be able to use it. Usually when they say they want their grandmother to be able to do it, it's they want to be able to do it themselves. You guys are the folks who can make that happen for them. And this multidimensional reality is really going to be about you driving lots of value, I think. So, you know, this is the example in those $75,000 and up households, 42 million of them. Today, maybe two services, maybe a few more. Maybe in the future, as packages for adults in those households, four services. So service diversity. Notice the companies that bring you those. The question mark, it could be Apple, it could be Disney, Fox, it will be. But different hardware, different software, and the need to be able to watch it when you want to watch it on all the devices in and out of the home. So that service diversity proves an interesting point wrong, which is, do you guys remember, like, this was the big media thing 4 or 5 years ago. No one's going to watch a movie on a mobile phone or a tablet or a TV show. Well, here are the numbers, and it's 2017. People surveyed. They have to have a phone or a tablet. It's a year ago. 55% had watched a full-length movie or a TV series, an episode on a mobile phone. Look at a tablet consumption. 81%. So slowly but surely, viewing time on portable devices, along with that connected big screen, is going to take share. And there's no doubt about it. And because of the business models, connected, targeted, engaging. Unfortunately, my slide got a little mashed up there. But it says the big screen will be the entertainment throne in the room. And this is truly the case, because quality really does matter. But you look at it as a place where we get in front of and have an experience where we can get nowhere else. And then we supplement what's coming to that screen with maybe lower fidelity inputs, which might be streaming services. Because as someone from Hollywood, a content guy, that big screen, there's nothing better for delivering that experience that is gut-wrenchingly emotional. Nothing better. Nothing. You look at 4K Ultra HD. Look at the bit rate. I mean, I'm not an engineer, but I know 128 megabits a second is a monster amount of data coming at that. And that frame rate, the experience is what the director wanted, the TV director, the sports guy. And ultimately, quality is not going away. Quality is not going away. It just happens to be more geolocated in the living room. It's not that people are necessarily going to think every room has to have as high quality. Some will want that, and it will be at a lower cost on a smaller size TV screen. But the problem we all have together, and we have to figure this out, remember those 2 to 24-year-olds that were watching less TV? Who remembers what happened to high-end headphone business when the iPod and iPhone came out? It really wasn't a good situation, because people put those buds in their head, and the convenience factor overrode the need for fidelity. Why do I say this? Because I want you to keep something in mind as you map out your strategies for the future. The enemy of the truly great is the good enough for a lot of people. And if you have income disparity and problems that you cannot afford the very great, you really have issues. Because I'm going to tell you, the picture on this thing with great audio and a good set of headphones is a damn good experience. And we all, content people, guys and gals, and folks in your world, the guys and gals, we have to come together to see that it's really about bringing this to an easier user experience, not just about quality. If not, we'll get, I think, a little bit behind, wrapped around behind the axle. Connected TVs will be the primary mode of consumption. We talked about this. For upper and middle class families, this will be the screen of choice to encourage social viewing. Also with home automation, other services, this is the place where you're going to be able to do it. Voice, is obviously a major paradigm shift in control, integration required across these different devices, Amazon, Google, and the like, but convenience and simple technology that brings an experience to a device, a subscription product to a device, a piece of content to a device in the home is really about making it better for the consumer, especially if that is, from a content guy's perspective, a subscription piece of content that they're looking at. So let's talk about what's ahead. We're almost there. Anybody have a feeling that this is sort of their life, where there's so much to watch, and how do you really find it? Well, the truth is that if you've heard about the paradox of choice, where there's too much to watch, or too much in the supermarket aisle, and you don't know what's good, you actually don't feel good. You literally can become moderately depressed. So with everything from your big screen to all the devices in your device ecosystem pumping out data into, you know, networks of content, technology companies, software stacks, AI and machine learning becomes the solution. Because without it, it's just wide open craziness. And Netflix has figured this out in its own ecosystem. But now this is an issue across ecosystems. And that's where we're going to have to see a lot more opportunity to make this easier for the consumer on the software level. This is really ultimately why AT&T is buying Time Warner, Disney is buying Fox. Because they need mass scale of content to put these types of machine learning and some people call it synthetic intelligence rather than artificial intelligence, to work to bring you what you want. Well, it's not always to be easy to be simple. Consumers always want choice, they want performance, and they want simplicity, but you just sort of remember these rat's nests that you see here. I just want to point out that locking you into one ecosystem does drive powerful economics and sometimes can make things easier to control. Like Apple actually is pretty darn good when you're in their world and making it a little bit easier. But with consumer choice so varied these days, few really want this. So this is one of the big opportunities in the room, which is you guys bring ecosystems together. You guys bring hardware, software, and solutions together in the home, home automation, home security. You make it easy. You have a great, great opportunity. I just wanted to point out that we just said it before, it's worth mentioning again, it's really about software platforms now, because these large players have software platforms that they're going to continuously run these engagement experiments on that define how their UI looks, define how their boxes work, all of what they have in their ecosystems to offer subscriptions, content, and targeting, not just in the US, globally, but software knowledge and the ability to integrate different software environments will be prized arts as they always have been. And I think that's a really unique thing that you guys hold vis-a-vis helping your clients out. I tried to get the Atmos sound. But what we're going to talk about in this last 3 minutes is you. Because I really do think with all of these mergers, direct-to-consumer, the technologies, software, the integration needs in the home, and remember, I'm just a content guy talking about this. I'm not mapping it out, what it's really going to be like, but I think these business model trajectories and content trajectories do help us see that the world is going to be more heterogeneous, and there's going to be those young people who want different things, and we're going to all have to contend with the big screen having a different role in the home. But really, really, really at the bottom of this, you guys are the ones that simplify things for people. You are the ones who make it seamless around entertainment, home control and automation, security services, and that's a privileged and very powerful position. You've always shown the ability to make the complex simple, and that's really important. And sometimes even the things that we think are simple aren't even simple enough. But on the other hand, in the world we're going to, it really does have to be simple. Maybe not grandma simple, but I need to be able to find the services on the devices when I want them, on the screen, with the right audio outputs, in my home and out of it when I want it. That's the basic assumption that people have now, because they're service and subscription focused, not just network focused. And really, you're wonderfully positioned to be the advocate and the educator for the consumer in the home. And I actually think there's some innovative new business models that you guys can try that just borrows a page off of what we've seen. And those business models would be things like, you know, the concierge medicine model. And believe me, I'm going out on a limb here, so don't hold me to all of these. But you pay for better services and access in concierge medicine. I don't know if you guys can do that, but I think it's an interesting concept. Another one is subscriptions to your own services, where you can develop recurring revenue streams. I know it's hard to figure out what those might be, but just think about the home network. We were talking about this the other night. Most people don't know what the propagation characteristics of their home network are in their home. Some people have wire lathing in their home. It's like a Faraday cage versus, you know, a big open environment. You guys can come in and offer suites of services that you're already doing, but then binds into this new personalized, much more two-way environment. And I think there are things there that you're probably bubbling up in your head, or you will, whether it's in content services, home automation, or security, that are really, I think, important. Ultimately, you're at the front lines of making this powerful new reality that's rolling out, because media companies are merging and technology companies are in a huge battle with those media companies. You're making it more friendly and easy for the consumer. You're reducing the set of choices they need to make so that they don't get cognitive overload, but get the services and the quality that they want. And ultimately, I think you guys simplify life, which is a wonderful thing, because those that simplify the complex usually do very well economically in worlds. So our final summary slide, conjuring simplicity, highest performance, and greatest value for customers is a winning strategy. Complexity, will be increasingly software driven. Interoperability, wonderful technologies around AI and machine learning that could be from major internet companies or from home automation companies that you'll see on the floor here. But that's really important. Software is more important than ever. Leveraging, as I was just saying, home control and automation is a wonderful entry point to doing more in the home. And as we've said, you are the customer's learning champion and trusted provider, so you really can, drive value here. So we've come a long way in the last 40 years around content, hardware, and software. You've played a central role in transforming what the media industries and the content industries have been able to bring to consumers, and I really do thank you for that. It's amazing, along with the technology companies that have worked with you to understand what consumers want. But the reality here is that we're all dealing with giants now. Internet companies that are content companies, media companies that have all combined with cable companies. These companies are so large that ultimately we're going to have to dance to their drumbeat as well, along with the economic and behavioral characteristics we saw. Time value, money value, and younger people not watching as much TV. But I really truly believe we are entering a golden age of content and technology, and you are extraordinarily well positioned at the center of that in the home to reap the benefits of the entertainment and technology industry's wars. And I really do encourage you wholeheartedly and thank you for your ability to go out and take those spoils of war. There it is. And make them your own and make money from them for you. So last but not least, I have 2 minutes. I know my time is up, but I would love to show you a video, because I designed this presentation for you specifically so it was not one of those traditional ones, which I hate sitting through, where the guy or gal is showing for their company, because I wanted to try and bring you some frameworks and some knowledge that I had, and I hope I've been able to do that for you. And I really do appreciate you not taking out your devices. It really meant a lot to me. But I do want to say one thing. I've only been at Fox for 18 months. I'm going to show you a reel that was shown at CinemaCon, which is the annual theatrical sales event in Las Vegas. And Fox is moving into Disney, so we're going to say goodbye to Fox. Maybe not as a brand, but as a company. But I just want you to see what this company created over the last 50 years. It's pretty extraordinary. Here we go. Turn up the volume.
I heard you had an amazing story.
We all got the spark tonight. Take it back the way we are. 'Cause that's just the way we are.
It's just such a great studio. For me, it's my home.
I'm the king of the world!
Ladies and gentlemen, you are not in Kansas anymore.
Thank you for your attention today. I really appreciate that. Have a great Expo 2018. And from the bottom of my heart, thank you for all you've done for the content industries. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
It's pretty good.